Hi, this is Topher with OS Training. In this series, we're going to begin a longer series about how to become a theme developer. Themes are the backbone of what make WordPress sites look the way they do. There's essentially an unlimited number of designs that a WordPress site can use. All of the ones that have been created, plus all of the ones that will be created, whether by you or someone else. You can create themes from scratch, or you can take an existing theme and tweak it a little bit and re-release it, because most themes are released under the general public license, and you're free to take an existing design and change it and make it your own and re-release it. Let's take a look at a few of the options. This is an entirely custom theme. The design was created by a designer and handed off to me to turn it into a WordPress theme. There are two parts to every theme, the front end and the back end. The front end is usually managed with CSS and HTML and JavaScript and things like that, whereas the back end is a collection of templates created with PHP. And we'll take a look at all of that material in a little bit. But there's another option. This is a list of the free themes at WordPress.org. You can create a theme and release it for free on WordPress.org, and they will host it for you. And they will even provide an SVN code repository so that you can keep it up to date with version control. There are currently many thousands of themes available on WordPress.org. These are just the featured, but there are 2,126 on the popular list. And it goes on and on and on. And here are the latest. All of these are available for you to download, use, examine, learn from, change, and maybe even re-release. If you find that you really enjoy making themes, it can be fun to release one on WordPress.org and to watch the world use it and see where it goes. Now, these are free themes, but there are also commercial themes. This is the site of Array Themes, and they create themes and sell them. Here's Paperback, Candid, Checkout, Pocket, Designer, etc. This theme costs $49. Now, one of the great things about buying a theme is that it comes with support. If you're confused or lost or it doesn't do something it should, you can ask them for help. One of the downsides about selling a theme is that you should probably provide support, and that can be painful. You have to carefully weigh whether it's worth the money that you're going to make from this theme. And maybe it is. Some people have made more than $1 million selling their theme. But some people don't. Some people make just a few hundred dollars a year, and you will personally need to weigh whether it's worth selling your theme. The Theme Foundry is another commercial theme site. They also sell themes. They have a small team of designers, developers, and support staff. This theme costs $79. You can optionally purchase something called Foundry Pro for $200, which gets you access to all of their themes, which is quite a deal because they have quite a few themes and they're each about $79. Another option is to use a service like the Envato Market at themeforest.net. You can simply upload your theme, and they provide the support for it. All you do is collect the money. The downside is they take a share, and it's a relatively large share because they're doing a lot of the work for you. You don't have to host it, you don't have to support it, you don't have to do any of that stuff. Many commercial theme designers got into the business by selling themes here on ThemeForest and other sites like it. Astoundify is another commercial theme shop that is kind of a hybrid of their own site as well as hosting on Envato. For example, this is their own site and they sell a theme called Marketify for $63. But over here on ThemeForest, they sell Marketify for $64. So they have it in both places, and there's nothing wrong with that. So the options for the things that you can do with your theme are pretty wide-ranging. You could simply build something for your own blog, Or you could build things for clients, custom themes for them. Or you could release for free. Or you could sell your themes. Your options are really wide open there. You can do anything you wish. In this series, we're going to be building a custom theme. And we're going to start with a theme called Underscores. And this is called a starter theme. It comes with essentially no design at all. But it does come with well-commented modern HTML5 templates, a 404 template, an optional sample custom header implementation, some custom template tags, and a whole variety of other things. Someone on ThemeShaper wrote an article called A 1,000-Hour Head Start Introducing the Underscores Theme. Because compared to starting from scratch, it's like having a 1,000-hour head start building the theme. When most people think of a theme, they think of the design. They don't think about the fact that there is an enormous amount of PHP in the background. Underscores provides all of that HTML and PHP, while you can apply the design. Underscores was created by all of these people. And I personally know many of them. And so it's exciting to see this theme go. Now, one of the unique things about Underscores is that you can create your own theme right from here. And you do it with this form. We're going to pull up the advanced options, and it just opens this up right here. And I'm going to make a theme about motorcycles. You can call yours anything you want. But my theme is going to have pictures of motorcycles, a catalog of motorcycles, galleries of motorcycles, and things like that. You can make yours do anything you wish, and you can call your theme anything you wish. If you're really unsure about what you're doing, or what you might want to be doing later, I suggest you create yours exactly the same as mine. It'll make less confusion in the future as I change things. So I'm going to call mine Motorcycles. Your theme slug is basically what the directory is called that holds all your files. And it's usually wise to make your slug the same as your theme name, but with hyphens instead of spaces and all lowercase. The rest of these are not required, but fun. There. Now we have an option called Sassify, which we're not going to use. But Sass is a CSS preprocessor. And if you're really into CSS, then I recommend you really get into Sass because it's good stuff. But to start out with, we're going to skip it and just use plain old classic CSS. And so now I'm going to hit Generate. And now it asks me to save a zip file. And I'm just going to put it right on my desktop. There. Now I have a theme called Motorcycles. From a code standpoint, it's a completely functional, well-coded theme. From a design standpoint, it's ugly. There's nothing there. It's just plain HTML. In this series, we're not going to look at the design. We're not going to look at the front end. That's going to be in the next series. In this series, we're going to look at how to build the back end. So that if somebody comes to you with a design in Photoshop or anything else and says, I want this to be WordPress, you'll know how to build the back end so that you can easily apply your design. I hope you'll join me for the rest of the series, and we'll take a look at how to install this theme, how to change it to make it our own, and how to really understand what's going on. In this video, we're going to install the theme that we made based on Underscores. I called mine Motorcycles. And then we're going to take a look at some of the files that make up a theme, both in our own theme, as well as some of the themes that you see here on this page. These themes came pre-installed with my WordPress install, Every year, WordPress releases a base theme, something that they want to build from. So here we have 2012 through 15. They started this in 2010, so there's also a 2010 and a 2011, but those don't come pre-installed anymore. So our theme was created at underscores.me, and then we saved it to my desktop. So now I'm going to add new, and then here at the top, upload theme, and there's my theme, motorcycles.zip. And now I'm going to activate. Now you'll note that there's no screenshot here. That's because we haven't made one. Again, underscores is not intended to be used out of the box as a regular theme. It's intended to be a base for you to build on. So at some point, we're going to create a screenshot and put it in there properly. And I'll show you when we get there. Let's take a look at the front end, and I'll show you what I mean about no design. That's it, right there. Here's the header and the subtitle. Here's the nav. Here's the post on the main page. Comments. There's a search box widget in the sidebar. And then here's the footer. If we go to the single page, again, you can see there's no design at all. And yet, you can tell that it's all working like a normal theme. So let's take a look at some of the files that come with this. This editor is called Sublime Text 2. You can download a free demo, which this is, or you can buy it and get support. So I'm going to go to File, Open. Now, I'm using desktop server, so I have a folder called Sites. And here are all my sites. And you can see here that I'm using mytheme.dev. And you can do this on any site. There's nothing particularly special about desktop server for what we're doing. I just like using it. So here's mytheme.dev. And then here's all of our regular WordPress files. We go to WP Content and Themes. And there's motorcycles. Rather than open a single file, I'm going to click open while I'm on the motorcycles theme. And now all my files are over here available to me. You can see I have several folders, inc for include, js for JavaScript, languages for translation files, layouts, template parts, and then a collection of PHP files. Most themes come with a similar collection of files. They're not all the same because some of them are optional, but most have them. For instance, here's an index.php file. If you're already a PHP developer, you know that index.php is the first file to load in a folder. And this one is the main template. But we also have header and footer.php. We have an archive.php for your archive, comments.php for your comments. On all of that, the main file that makes a theme is style.css. And you can see here in the header, there's a comment, theme name, motorcycles, theme URI, underscores.me, author, Topher, etc. Now these things were created by that form that we filled out on underscores.me. I'm going to remove that backslash. And we can see this information right within WordPress if we go to theme details. There's that slash that I just took out. So if I reload, you can see that it's gone. So it takes the word motorcycles here from theme name, the theme URI from the next field, author and author URI are here. Here's the description. And then here's a screenshot, which we don't have yet. Version 1.0.0 comes from here. And we don't have any tags, so it doesn't list them. But this header, right here, is the most important part of your theme. It's what makes a WordPress theme a WordPress theme. Without it, you don't have a theme. You have a collection of PHP files. We'll go over that in more depth later. Now, Motorcycles also comes with some include files. It comes with two different CSS layouts. It comes with some template parts. They're just fragments of pages that get included in various places. We'll look at those later also. But for right now, I want to take a look at another theme. Let's take a look at 2015. So here's 2015, and you'll see that some things are similar. There's Ink, JS, and Languages. But here we have a CSS folder with a collection of CSS files. Our theme doesn't have that. There's a folder called Genericons. It's a collection of icon fonts, so that you can use a letter on your keyboard to print an icon of a camera, for example. Here we have some content fragments, content link, content none, content page, etc. In Motorcycles, those are in template parts, and they're different. And that's okay. It's okay to have different files. What's important is how your code treats these files, how it calls them, where it puts them, and in what order. Again, these are all things that we're going to take a look at. But I wanted to show you in this video how themes are both similar to each other and different from each other. There's more than one way to get something done. And some themes are pretty dramatically different. And that's okay. Feel free to experiment and learn and grow. Try things, break things, fix things. This is an exciting, organic process. And when we get to the end, I hope we have something that is uniquely you. In this video, we're going to take a look at template hierarchy. This is going to tell us which file WordPress will use to show certain kinds of content. For example, what file is used to show the homepage, or a single post, or a page, or anything, really. We're looking here at the theme handbook on WordPress.org, which is an entire handbook on how to build themes. I strongly recommend you become familiar with it. I wrote a small part of this one. But this page looks at the template file hierarchy. Something I want to make clear to you is how the hierarchy cascades. WordPress looks first for some very specific files. And if it can't find them, it looks for a different set of files. And if it can't find them, it looks for another set of files. And it starts specific and gets more general. For example, let's look here at number one. Let's say you have a category in WordPress called unicorns. To render that category in your browser, WordPress is going to look for a file called category-unicorns.php. Now, your theme's probably not going to have that. If somebody else built it, they have no idea that you're going to have unicorns. If you built it, you might have made that file. Regardless, it's going to look there. If that file is missing and the category's ID is 4, it's going to look for category-4.php. Again, a commercial theme designer or one on WordPress.org is not going to make that file, but you might have. If it's missing, it's going to look for category.php. Now, this is probably going to exist. It's very common for theme developers to make this, and then all the categories look the same. However, it's not required, and if it doesn't exist, then WordPress is going to look for archive.php, which is, again, very, very common, and you probably have one, but is not required. The only one that's really required is index.php. Now, everything in your whole site would look exactly the same, but that's all that's required. So if your archives are all going to look the same, and they're all going to look the same as index.php, you don't really need to make an archive.php. Just use index.php. So that's how the cascade works. It looks specifically for this particular kind of category, then this one, then something very generic, then something even more generic, and then the most generic of all. Now, there's a great chart here that shows the entire hierarchy. You can see that it looks first for index.php, then singular, or home, or comments, or 404, or search. And then from those, it branches off into all of these others. And it's a little confusing. And by the end of the series, I hope you'll be able to understand it a little better, because I'm going to work really hard to explain it. But going back to this page, there's a nice text description that I have found to be more useful. The first thing on your site, really, is your home page. So WordPress is going to look first for home.php. If it doesn't exist, then it looks for index.php. One of these needs to exist, otherwise the theme won't work. There's a note here. If front-page.php exists, it will override the home.php template. Now, neither home nor front page are all that common, but they're not unheard of, and it is common for a theme developer to inherit a theme and not be able to figure out why the home page looks that way. And then someone reminds them, look for home.php or front-page.php, and there's everything. So we're going to look first for a home page display or front page display. Now, if you're looking at a single post, WordPress is not going to look for those files. It's going to look for first single-posttype-slug.php, which is very, very specific, and you're really only going to have one if you make it yourself. But then it's going to look for single-posttype.php. That's probably not going to exist either, but it might. For example, my theme is about motorcycles. I could make a template just for motorcycles, but I'm not going to yet. Then it looks for single.php, which is extremely common, and every theme has one. Then it looks for singular.php, which is slightly different, but not exactly the same. And then, as always, falls back to index.php. Now, these are for single posts. Pages look first for a custom template file assigned to the page, and this can be done right within the WordPress GUI. In fact, let's take a look. Go to your theme, go to Pages, and here's Sample Page. And my theme, Motorcycles, does not have any custom templates, so I don't have a box here for it. However, if we change themes to 2014 and edit our page, you'll see that it comes with some custom templates. So for pages, which are different from posts, we can say, use this template file. I don't care whatever WordPress says, use this one. So for pages, it looks first for that declaration. Then it looks for page-slug, which again is very specific and will probably only exist if you make it. And the same goes for page ID. But then it looks for page.php, which is extremely common and is in just about every theme ever. And that's for rendering pages. But if you don't have one, then it looks for singular.php and then index. Categories are similar. Looks for category slug, which probably doesn't exist, then ID, then category.php, then archive, then index. Tags work the same as categories. Tag-slug, tag-id, tag.php, archive.php, and index.php. Custom taxonomies, custom post types, authors. If you want to render an author page, have an author.php file. If you'd like the president of the site to have his own author display, make author dash and then their WordPress username. There are some date-based archive index pages, and they look first for date.php, then archive, then index. Search results show up in search.php or index.php. 404 pages look first for 404.php, then index.php. Attachments, which could be images or audio or video or anything like that, can show up first in a template called image.php or video.php or application.php or attachment.php, and then falling back to single attachment, falling back to single, and falling back to index. We'll look at filter hierarchies later. But what's very important to understand is that each file is intended to render a certain kind of information. And if that file doesn't exist, it's okay. There's another file that it's going to look for that can render that, all the way back to index.php. Now, it can be confusing to know which template file you're looking at when you're looking at the front end of your site. So let's take a look at a very cool plugin. We'll go to Add New, and go ahead and install this on your own site. It's called What Template File Am I Using? And here's the plugin. Let's install it and activate it. Now, this only works if you're logged in. So you can install this on a live site and it won't cause any issues at all. But now we're looking at our homepage here. We switched to 2014 a while ago. Now I have this tab over here. What template file am I using? And it tells me we're using 2014 index.php. We're looking at a post. It's the front, it's the home, it's not 404, and it's not search. Additional files used are header, sidebar content, sidebar, footer, and content. It has one primary sidebar with a search widget in it, and these are the enqueued scripts and styles. It even tells us things like our own IP address, server variables, which I hope you never need to use, and PHP info. But now let's click on a post. So now we're not on the homepage anymore, and it's using single.php, which is interesting because I would have thought it would use post.php. Now let's click on sample page, and we'll look at a page. And now it's using page.php. But let's change themes and see what that gets us. We'll go back to motorcycles and reload. And we're still on sample page. So this theme uses page.php. The homepage uses index.php. A single post uses single.php. So it's using similar template files to 2015. Let's do a quick search. And you can see that now we're on search.php. This tool is extremely useful when you've inherited a theme and someone has done something clever, like include template parts on a weirdly named hierarchy file, and you can't figure it out just from looking at the backend. This plugin will tell you exactly what template file is being used and what it's being used for and what it's including. So we're going to make a lot of use of this plugin as we go forward. A common problem with themes today is including functionality with the theme. For example, at some point in another series, we're going to create a custom post type for our theme called motorcycles, where we can enter in motorcycles and we can make them do different things. But that shouldn't be part of the theme, because I want to keep my motorcycles when I change my theme to Motorcycle 2 or some other theme altogether. That said, every theme comes with a functions.php file, and in there you can include some random PHP that you need to do things. Let's take a look at the one that comes with our motorcycles theme. It's right here called functions.php. At the top we have a header that says motorcycles function and definitions, a link to where we can learn about what kinds of things should go in here, and a package line which says that this is part of the motorcycles theme. Now the first thing we want to do is run a setup function. And so we check to see if our motorcycle setup function exists already. We might already have a motorcycles plugin or something that has a function called motorcycle setup. So if we don't have one, then we create one, motorcycle setup. Then we're going to set up a variety of things. Now you're probably never going to have to mess with this. But if you ever build a theme from scratch, you're going to want something very similar to this. The first thing we're going to do is make the theme available for translation. Translation in WordPress is done with .pot files, P-O-T. And this line tells us where ours are. They're in the languages folder of our theme. And right over here you can see motorcycles.pot and a README file. The README file says place your theme language files in this directory. Now what's cool about underscores is that it creates an English translation file for you. So as long as you're using English, you don't really ever have to mess with this. However, the structure is there for someone to translate your theme into another language. What's even cooler is on WordPress.org, they have a system set up where anyone can translate your theme for you. Now, this is only if your theme is hosted on WordPress.org. But let's go back to functions. Load theme text domain. So we're loading our translation files. Next, we're declaring whether or not we want RSS feed links in the header. Not out on the front where people can see it, but in the head section of your HTML. So we're adding theme support for automatic feed links. So it will magically figure out where our RSS is and link to it in the header file. Next, we're declaring theme support for the title tag. And by this, we're saying we want to let WordPress manage the document title. So on every page, it gets a different title. On the home page, it gets a different title, etc. You don't have to do any of this, but it can be extremely useful to allow WordPress to manage it, because then you don't have to write the code for it. And you do want a different title on every page. Google likes that. Next, we're declaring theme support for post thumbnails. These are featured images. WordPress does not do that out of the box. You have to say in your theme that you want post thumbnails. And so this is where we're doing it. Now, we're registering a nav menu called primary menu. And it's the primary menu for our theme. If we go over to the admin and go to menus, we don't really have a menu yet. They have filled one in here for us, but we haven't hit create yet. So now I'm going to create this menu. And here we have this theme location, which was created right here in functions.php. And so we can say this menu is the primary menu. And now our theme knows what to do with it. We'll take a look at that again when we get to the header file. Next, we're going to add theme support for some HTML5 elements, mostly forms with a gallery, image caption, and a comment list. This takes the original code and converts it to HTML5 code. Again, this is optional and you don't have to. If you get HTML from your designer, that HTML may be HTML5 and you want this, or it may be HTML4 and you don't want this. It's entirely up to you. But next, we're going to enable support for post formats. If you're familiar with Tumblr, these are very similar. You can say that a certain blog post is an image or a video or a quote, etc. You don't have to add theme support for these post formats, but if you're going to use them, it can be awfully handy. If you're not going to use them, I don't recommend turning them on. So for example, if you're building a custom theme for a business and you know they're never going to use it, don't turn them on. You'll reduce the overhead. But if you're releasing a theme for WordPress.org or commercial, then you probably want to offer this to your customers. And lastly here, we're adding theme support for a custom background feature. By default, we're setting it white and we're not having an image. But later we'll look at the customizer and I'll show you how we can use this theme support function to create a GUI for your end users to set up a custom background. This end if is the end of our test to see if this function exists. And then we use something called a hook. We're going to run our motorcycle setup function on a hook called after setup theme. So once our theme is all set up, we run our setup file, which adds to it. We'll take a more in-depth look at hooks in another video. And we're going to finish this function files in another video as well. In this video, we're going to pick up in the middle of the functions.php file. We're looking here at line 83. So go ahead and open up yours and follow along with me. The first thing we're going to do here is set the content width in pixels based on the theme's design and style sheet. Now, this is not at all what I thought it was the first time I ever read it. It sounded to me like we were setting the width of our design, of our site, but we're not. We're setting a maximum width for certain kinds of embedded content. Let me show you an example. This is one of my favorite YouTube videos, The Baby Panda Scares Its Mother to Death. So I'm going to copy this address, and I'm going to go to Pages, going to edit my sample page. And right here at the top, I'm going to paste that in. Now here in my editor, it makes it really big. But if I go to update and review this page, now there's no CSS setting the width on this. I didn't put in any HTML. I didn't make any restrictions at all. But this video is only 640 pixels wide because we set it right here. Now you can set this to anything you wish. You're making this theme. You can know how wide your content is. You can look at your design and say, the content area is going to be full width. I don't have a sidebar, so let's set this to 960, or 1000, or 1024, or anything you wish. But embedded content is what this number is for, and that's videos or audio players or large image galleries or anything like that. So we've created a function called motorcycles content width, and we set a globals content width and apply filters motorcycles content width 640. Then we run our function after setup theme. Now the zero is a priority, which means run this first, before, for example, this one that we looked at in the last video. If there is no priority, then it defaults to 10. Again, this is not required, but it can make things a lot nicer for the people managing your website. Now we're going to register a widget area, commonly called a sidebar. But it doesn't have to be only in the side, it could be in the footer or wherever. So these days we call them widget areas. So we create a function called motorcycles widgets init. You'll note that all my functions start with the term motorcycles. That's to make it different from every other theme in the world. So within my function, I have another function called register sidebar, which comes from WordPress, and it has an array of options. A name, it's called sidebar. An ID, sidebar 1, we have no description. And then before the widget, in our HTML, we have an aside, and after it, a closing aside, and the title is an H2 with a class of widget title. Now let's take a look at that real quick. Go with me to Appearance, Widgets, and we have one sidebar. Now we're going to edit the description right here. Just to say my custom sidebar. Then we save, and I'm going to reload this page. And right there it says my custom sidebar. So you can say anything you want there. So to reiterate, under description, under register sidebar, I simply wrote my custom sidebar. And it put the description right here. Now just for fun, I'm going to copy this whole section and paste it right there. And we'll call this sidebar 2 with an ID of sidebar 2. We'll call it my other custom sidebar. And that's it. I've only changed those things. Now I'll save it and we will reload. And you'll see I have sidebar 2. Now the front end is not prepared to handle this. And we'll take a look at that in another video. But that's how easy it is to make sidebars. So you could make a footer widget area, you could make a header widget area, or anything you wish. Now to make this work, we use add action, and here's our function name, and we hook it to widgets init, and that creates our widget areas. Now, we're going to look at enqueuing all of our CSS and JavaScript and anything else we want. We create a function called motorcycle scripts, and the first thing we do is enqueue the main style.css file, which does almost nothing out of the box, but we still want to include it because we're going to add some styles later. Then, in the JS folder, we have a navigation.js file, which is used to help some older browsers deal with mobile navigation. So we're doing WP and Q script. We're giving it a handle. Then with a path, get template directory URI, which is the path to our theme. And then appending /js/navigation.js. It wants an array of dependencies, but we don't have any, so we just put in an expiration date. And whether or not it should be in the footer. And it is. So that includes navigation.js. Then another JavaScript file called skip link focus fix. And this is just a fix for some older browsers. And then if we're looking at a singular file and comments are open and we have threaded comments, we want to enqueue the script comment reply. So let's take a look at our source and see what we have there. All right, here is style.css, which is the first thing we included. Then we had navigation.js. And here that is below the footer. And right next to that is the skip link focus fix, and below that is the comment reply. So that's how we get various JavaScript files and CSS files to be included. And we'll take another look at that later. Now the function that holds all of these is called motorcycle scripts, and we run it with add action on WP and Q scripts. And that makes sure all of these things get in just the right place at just the right time in just the right way. The rest of this file includes some bits and pieces. And we're going to take a look at the contents of the ink folder in another video. In this video, we're going to take a look at something called template tags. If you're already a PHP developer, then I'd like to be clear that template tags are simply functions. They're used to either do something or return something within templates. We're looking here at the WordPress codex. I simply Googled WordPress template tags and this was at the top. You can do this in your own browser and follow along, or you can simply watch as I go through. The top of this page lists some excellent documentation about template tags, how to make them, when to use them, etc. We're going to do a brief overview in this video, and then in the next couple of videos, we're going to go in depth on how to use them. Here's the list of tags. These are general tags, and they're created in a WordPress file called general-template.php, which hopefully you'll never have to touch. But here are some examples of these tags. Get header and get footer. These go on the top and bottom of pretty much every template in your whole theme. Get sidebar takes care of going to get a sidebar and rendering it in your theme. Get template part allows you to have small parts of your theme all over the place, and you can include just the right ones in just the right places. Get search form will print to the screen a search form with all of the right pieces in all of the right places. WP login out will either render a form or a logout link. All you have to do is return this function, and you get either the form or the logout. And all of these do something similar. You can print a single post title, your site title, the single term title, etc. Here we have some author tags. The author will print information about the author. Get the author will return that information so you can store it in a variable and do something with it later. Many template tags work that way. They'll have something that begins with the, and then another one that begins with get that's very similar, and one of them prints and one returns. Here's one that lists all the authors on the site in a bulleted list. So you don't have to write any code to figure out who the authors are, what their links are, what posts they've done, or any of that. You simply print WP list authors, and you get exactly that. Here are some category tags. These are extremely useful. If you're looking at a post and you want to know what categories that post is in, You simply run one of these template tags, and it will print them all out for you. Comment tags, so you can get all the information about comments. Link tags. The permalink is the link to any given post or page. Get permalink will return it so you can store it in a variable. There's home URL for your homepage, site URL for your website. Post tags. These are all the different parts of a post. There's the content, the excerpt, the ID, the meta, the tags, the title. All of that information about a post. We're going to go in depth on these things in a future video, so I'm not going to go too deep now. But template tags are going to be your friend when building a theme. A large part of building a theme is simply knowing where to put the right tags. You put them in the right place, and you'll end up with a very functional theme. Not with design, but in everything in the right place so that you can design it exactly the way you want it. We have post thumbnail tags and navigation menu tags. Now you can also create your own template tags. Here's a real quick look at how these tags are used. We're looking at the index file of our motorcycles theme. Go ahead and open it up. It's index.php in your theme. Right here, below our content, is the post's navigation. Now this is assuming that we're looking at an archive, and so it's going to create next and previous links. There are some others in here as well. There's get template part, there's get sidebar, and get footer. Up at the top we have get header. Here's one called have posts, which figures out whether or not we have any posts. Is home, is front page. Those figure out if we're on the home page or the front page. And we're printing here single post title. Now you can create your own template tags, and underscores does that. Under the ink folder is a file called template tags. In here we have one called posted on, and it's prefixed with motorcycles, our theme name. And what this does is print a very attractive date string. WordPress can print a date string, but this one is more attractive and includes some special HTML that Google likes. So we use an HTML5 element called time, and within it, we print the time and date, etc. We also have a function called entry footer. So our template tag is motorcycle entry footer. And it includes a number of things like categories list, tags list, comments list, and a link to edit the post. WordPress doesn't normally include this. This is entirely in the realm of the theme. Here we have one called categorized blog. It returns true if a blog has more than one category. So this is simply a way to know if your blog has more than one category. And then here at the bottom we have a transient flusher. Transients are small bits of cached information to help your site go faster. But sometimes you want to get rid of the cache so that people get the latest information. So this function will clear the transient motorcycles categories, which is just a list of the categories. And that's it for this file. There aren't very many extras added on. But I wanted to show you this file to show that you can create as many template tags as you wish, and you can make them do anything you want, and then print them any place in your theme. In this video, we're going to start putting together everything we've learned so far. Once you learn the basics, it's not all that complicated, especially if you have a 1,000-hour head start like we do with underscores. We're looking here at our homepage, which has a header, a content area, a sidebar, and a footer. And our plugin tells us that we're looking at index.php. So let's take a look at index.php. Go ahead and pull it up with me. You can pause the video while you pull it up if you like, and I will wait right here. At the top of this file is a comment block. It's the main template file. And it says this is the most generic template file in a WordPress theme, and one of the two required files for a theme, the other being style.css. It is used to display a page when nothing more specific matches a query. Example, it puts together the home page when no home.php file exists. There's a link to the template hierarchy, and it tells us what package it's part of. Now, the first thing that should happen in any template that is intended to present a page is a template tag called getHeader. And this is the header of your site. And it should be the same on every page. It doesn't have to be. And in an advanced series, we'll take a look at how to do something a little different. But for the most part, you should have the same header on every site. And all this really does is call header.php. Let's take a look at that too. Go ahead and pull it up and I'll wait. Now this says it's the header for our theme. This is the template that displays all of the head section and everything up until div ID content. So if you remember your HTML, you'll note that here it starts with a doc type. And then there's the HTML tag and the head tag and the meta tags and the link tags. And then right here is a template tag called WP head. In an earlier video, we looked at some enqueuing functions that pulled in some CSS and some JavaScript and things like that. All of that ends up in WP head. So let's take a look at our web page at the source just from head to head right here. We'll start up here. There's our doc type. And there's our HTML lang ENUS. Over here, we had a template tag called language attributes. And it simply prints the proper one. Then we have head and meta care set and another template tag called blog info care set, which gets us UTF-8. Then we have some hard-coded HTML. Except for the pingback, which has another template tag for blog info. And here's the pingback. Next in our HTML is the title tag. But we don't have that here. That's because everything else after this link tag is managed by WP head. It gets our settings from general settings to make the title tag. And it makes the title tag and a robots file and links to XML for our RSS. It includes all of our JavaScript, all of our CSS, and all of that stuff till we get down here to end our head. And you, as theme developer, do not need to worry about any of this stuff. WordPress takes care of it for you. That's one of the real joys of WordPress and building sites with it. WordPress manages all of this stuff for you. But now we have a body class. Let's see what's going on in our template file. Here's our body tag, and it simply has a template tag called body class. And body class knows how to figure out all kinds of CSS classes. For example, we're on the home page. It's a blog page. We're logged in. We have an admin bar. There's no customizer support on this page, and it has HFeed classes throughout. Then we have the HTML header. We start with a div ID page, which wraps the entire site. We have our skip link for screen reader text. And then here we have the HTML5 element header with site branding. And it says, if we're on the front page and it's home, print the site title as an H1. Otherwise, print the site title as a paragraph tag. Then it gets the description, which is the site description. In this case, just another WordPress site. And it puts it in a paragraph tag. Then it has the site navigation. And then it closes the header, and it starts the body content with an ID of content. Let's take a look at the HTML for that. There's our ID page. There's the screen reader. Here's our header with a masthead with our site branding, H1, site title, our site description. There's the site navigation. And we close our header, and there's the beginning of the content. So all of that material was handled for you in index.php by getHeader. And it will be managed for you on every template you make. So once you've made your first one, just like this index.php file, All that material is managed for you, and you don't need to think about it ever again. The same holds true for getFooter. If we look at footer.php, it's far less complicated. In this case, it simply prints out what site we're on and who made it. But then it also includes a template tag called wp-footer, which can also print JavaScript files and all kinds of things. So all that to say, every template should be wrapped in getHeader and getFooter, and they manage the top and bottom of your website for you wonderfully. But now let's take a look at the contents of index.php. We have a div called primary, which wraps the entire area. Then we have another one called main. And then we start in with some PHP. And this is where we start getting content. The first thing we're going to do is check to see if we have posts. So this if should end here with an else. Then here on line 22, we say, if it's home and it's not the front page, then print the single post title, which then by contrast means if it is the front page, don't print the title. Then we start the loop. In WordPress parlance, the loop is going to the database, getting content, bringing it back, and printing it. So we say, while we have posts, run the post. So it's going to go through each post and filter each one through the function called the post, which gets information about that post. But then right here, we have a get template part, and we end our end while. What's inside this get template part determines what each post looks like. So we're going to look inside the folder called template parts. And the way get template part works is it automatically appends .php to whatever we have right here. Also, it takes the first part, then hyphenates it with the second part. So in another video, we set up some post formats. We could make video or post or image or whatever. So this is looking for files called content-video, content-post.php, etc., in the template parts folder. But if we look there, you'll see that we don't actually have those. Underscores assumes that you will create them if you need them. So because we don't have one, it's simply going to call content.php. So to reiterate, while we have posts, get the post information, and then include content.php. Let's take a look in there. So this is a single article in a loop. So we use the HTML5 element article, and it ends here at the bottom. And then on line 13, we have a header. And then we print the title, and we wrap the title in some HTML here. Then we say if the post type is post, then we want to print some HTML about the entry meta and run our custom-made template tag, motorcycles posted on. You may recall in our last video that we looked at our own custom template tags. Then we get the content, except we don't simply print it. We run it through a security function called wp-cases, which reads through it and strips out anything that could be written by a hacker. And you can see that we've also wrapped it in a span. And we also reprint the title with screen reader text HTML around it. Then WP link pages before and after. This links to posts before and after this one in a blog archive. And then we have motorcycles entry footer. This is another custom template tag that we looked at in another video. So all of this content gets run right here on line 38. So again, to reiterate, while we have posts, get some information about the post, and feed it into this content file over and over again until we're out of posts. After we're done, print the post's navigation. This else says, if we don't have posts, print content-none.php. If we take a look at that one, you'll see that it does not try to print posts. It says, if you're logged in and you're allowed to, ready to publish your first post? Or, if you're searching and you got no results, sorry, but nothing matched your search terms. Or, it seems we can't find what you're looking for. So, content-none is really quite short and simple. So back to index.php. While we have posts, print this template part, and the post navigation, or if we don't have posts, print content-none. Now, after all of this, closing the primary div, we also say get sidebar. Now, the fact that your sidebar is outside of your primary div is a design decision. You may need to change this once you have the design from your designer, but you may not. We'll see in the next series. Now, just for fun, let's change something here on index.php. We have one post, Hello World, and then it says posted on, and then there's a link. Just for kicks, let's put an exclamation point after posted on. And I'll save it, and we'll reload. And there's our exclamation point. So now, every single post is going to have that exclamation point after it. But let's take it back out on line 18 there. And reload, and now it's gone. A great deal of learning how to theme is messing around with these template files. Add things, remove things, move them around, use different template tags to see what they output, because there are dozens, hundreds of template tags. There are a dozen different ways to print an image. I strongly recommend that you dig into these template files and you simply start changing things. Add things, remove things, break things, start over. That's how you're going to really learn this stuff. I can tell you about it all day long, but until you get your hands on it and change things, you're never really going to understand. In our next video, we'll take a look at some other template pages and we'll see how they're different from index.php. In this video, we're going to look at a variety of things. Starting with the comments template. We're looking at a single post here, and if we open up our template viewer, it says we're looking at single.php, but additional files used, here we have comments.php. So let's take a look inside comments.php. Go ahead and open it up in your editor. I'll wait. Now this file is actually quite complicated because comments are hard. You're allowing input from the end user. And many of them want to put terrible, terrible things onto your site. And so this file is very carefully built. If you're going to build your own from scratch, I recommend that you learn from as many other themes as possible. Open up the 20 series comments.php and look at what they do. Look inside this one and see what they do, because you want to be very secure here. Honestly, if you're building your own theme off of underscores the way we are here, you probably don't need to edit this template file at all. The HTML is excellent, and you can style it any way you like with your CSS. But let's take a quick look anyway. The very first thing we have here at the top is post password required. If this returns true, then we simply return in this file and nothing happens. This file ends. So what that means is that if there is a post password required, then do not print out the comments. Now this is not true. If the visitor enters the password properly, then we do get the comments. So we start with a div for comments, and then we have a template tag that tests. Do we have comments? If we don't, skip all this stuff because we don't have comments. If we do, then print one thought on post title. etc. And then we can print the comment's number and then the title. And you can see that right here. Then if we have more than one, we put in some navigation. We print out the comments list, and then we have navigation again. And then at the bottom here, we have the comment form, which you can see here. Now, I'm not going to go into too much more depth because, honestly, I recommend you do not mess with this. Once you get to the point where you feel like you are an advanced theme developer, then by all means, dive in, tear it apart, and make the most awesome comments template you can make. But until then, it's dangerous, it's complicated, and it's not very much fun. And we have an excellent example right here, so I wouldn't mess with it. The next thing we're going to look at are the contents of the INC folder, Inc., for includes. These things are all included in functions.php. So we're looking here at functions.php, and I'm at the bottom. Go ahead and go there in your editor. Line 142 includes custom header.php. Now, before we look inside there, let's take a look at what it does. If I go to the admin area, under appearance, there's a header link. And if I click it, it brings up the customizer, and I can add a new image. And then I can select and crop. Crop image and save and publish. Now, I don't actually have the code in my theme itself to render this image. All this does so far is enable this functionality. If I don't want that functionality, all I have to do is put two slashes in front of that line and it comments it out. So now if I come over here and reload, the header menu item is gone altogether. So let's put it back and save. And now let's take a look inside custom header.php. Now this block at the top is only pink because my editor turns code inside a comment pink. There's nothing really special about it, but it says you can add an optional custom header image to header.php like so. So this is the code that's not in my theme. So let's go ahead and grab it, and we'll open up header.php. So we're inside our body, we're inside our header, and here's site branding. So I'm actually going to enter that code right before the site branding. There. Now let's load our homepage. And there's our banner. Now what's interesting is that underscores enabled the ability to create that header, but did not for us put in the code to make it work. We had to enter it ourselves. But now that it's there, it'll work every time. This is another file I'm not going to go into too much depth with. This is a feature. This is functionality. It is related to your theme because it's related to how it looks. But personally, I might put this in a plugin rather than part of the function, or rather than part of the theme. This code works deeply with the customizer, which is that tool that we used to insert the header. And speaking of which, we have a file called customizer.php. And this one adds support for site title and description in the theme customizer, and then binds JS handlers to make the theme customizer preview reload changes asynchronously, so that when you make a change with a customizer, you get to magically see it on the right. So this includes settings for the blog name, blog description, and header text color. Let's take a look at those. There's the title and the description. and there's header text color. Again, this is code I'm not going to get into too much depth with. This is considered advanced theme development. But the customizer is the future of customizing an individual theme. And at some point, I strongly recommend you take the customizer course so that you can see how to add things like this. Also in functions.php is template-tags, which we looked at in an earlier video. Then we have extras.php, and this is kind of a catch-all. Wherever you need to put some extra code, we have one built in, motorcycle body classes, and it adds a class of group blog to blogs with more than one published author. Occasionally you'll find tutorials online that say, simply put this code in your functions.php file. Don't do that. It's bad. It's a terrible idea. If you absolutely had to, if the code was related to design rather than functionality, with this theme you'd put it in extras.php. But generally you should put that code in a plugin. We also have a file here called jetpack.php, which tests to see if Jetpack is installed, and if it is, automatically turns on some of those plugins, like Infinite Scroll and Responsive Videos. If you don't want that in your theme, you could simply comment out the Add Action line, and it would get rid of it. That wouldn't prevent your end users from turning on Infinite Scroll and Responsive Videos, but it wouldn't automatically turn them on either. So in this video, I basically told you not to mess around with this stuff until you become more advanced. Comments.php is complicated and painful and dangerous. Be very, very careful with it. Most of the things in Ink I would consider functionality, except the template tags. Those are excellent for your theme. But the custom header and the customizer and the stuff in extras, I would personally put in a plugin. But since it's here, I would just leave it alone and use it the way it is. It's not going to break anything, and it's not really going to hurt anything. It's mostly a personal preference on my part. This video series covered how to manage the back end, the code part of a theme. Obviously, we also need to add the front end, all of the CSS and JavaScript. Otherwise, we end up with something that looks like this, which is horrible. But once those two things are together, you may want to release your theme. And we're going to look at just a few things here to get ready for that. Now, many of the things in here aren't relevant to this series. For example, make sure your CSS validates. Well, we don't have any of that. So we're going to move on down. One of their suggestions is that you start with a default or classic theme. Underscores isn't listed here, but that's what we did. We started with underscores. Here they talk about reconsidering plugins. Don't include functionality in your theme. Make sure that anything in your theme is related to design and display. Here we talk about styling all the template files, which will be in a next series. And then here we have the section on promoting your theme. Some things that you need to do. One of the things that you need to do is have an excellent README file. Underscores comes with one that was built when we initially created it on their website. At the top, it shows motorcycles, and then there's contributors. There's automatic, but then I also wrote some stuff. So feel free to put your WordPress.org username in the contributors list. For tags, you can't put in just anything. There's a limited set, and you can find those tags on this page, Designing Themes for Public Release, and on the WordPress Codex. You want to make sure you have a requires at least, and this is a WordPress version, 4.0. Test it up to, and how late you've tested it. Stable tag is what version we're working on for this theme. This is 1.0. And then there's some licensing information. Then we have a very short description, and then we have a longer description. The equal signs matter. They're used by some parsers on WordPress.org to render some of this information. So make sure that you have the equal signs properly put in there. Then we have installation instructions, a frequently asked questions file, and you'll note that these start with a single equals, and the answers have nothing. Then there's a change log and some credits. This file is important and required if you're going to release on WordPress.org. Another file is your screenshot. If we look at our themes folder, each of these has a screenshot, but ours does not. An easy way to find out what size it should be and what it should be called is to right-click on one of these and open the image in a new tab. Here in the tab title bar, we can see that the image is 880 by 660, and it's called screenshot.png right in the theme folder. So I have a screenshot that I made, and I'm going to call it screenshot.png. Then, in Finder, I'm going to go to Sites, mytheme.dev, WP Content, Themes, Motorcycles, and I'm simply going to drag it in here. It says there's one already, but it's empty. So I will just drag this right over here and replace, and now reload here. And there's my screenshot. And that's all there is to it. Make one in the right dimensions, 880 by 660. Call it screenshot.png and drop it in your theme folder. Now, ideally, you'd want to do this after you're done designing so that you get a screenshot that looks really beautiful and looks like your theme rather than my ugly thing here. At this point, our theme is ready from a PHP standpoint to have CSS applied to it. We might need to fiddle with some of the templates for HTML if our designer has given us something really unique. But that's fine. We know how to do that. We can simply open up page.php and include any HTML or PHP we need to. As I've mentioned several times, feel free to mess around with these templates, change things, move things around, break it and fix it. It's the best way to learn. In a future series, we're going to take this theme and we're going to style it and we're going to make it look really nice. And then in still yet another future series, we're going to include some custom content types for motorcycles and create some of our own templates so that we can render them very nicely. Hi, this is Topher with OSTraining.com. In this series, we're going to continue our path toward becoming a theme developer. In this particular video, we're going to do some rudimentary CSS. We've been working with the underscores theme, which really doesn't come with very much CSS at all. It mostly comes with some reset values, and I can show you those real quick. This is the CSS for the theme, and there's the header, there's the table of contents, and then here's the CSS. And most of it is reset things like this, which just set all of these things to be block. And all of these things to be inline block, and so on and so forth. And it just goes on and on, setting minor details for regular HTML elements. And then we get all the way to the bottom, and they do some styles for galleries, which you can see here, and some captions and things like that. But other than that, it's very, very mundane, which is why our theme looks so boring. Now, we're not really covering design in this series, but on the other hand, some structure would be useful. So we're going to take what we have here and we're going to make it look at least a little bit like a website. I'm using Firefox and I'm going to use a tool called Firebug. I have it installed already, but for right now I'm going to right click and go Inspect Element with Firebug. And this is the structure for the website. Here's our head, and then there's the body. And when I hover over it, you can see that the whole thing is blue. But then there's a div for the entire page. And again, everything is blue because it wraps the entire site. But then inside that, we have a link here for screen reader text, which is hidden by default. But then we have the header, Then we have the site content. And then if we scroll down a little bit, you'll be able to see the footer. But we also want a sidebar. And there isn't a sidebar right now, simply because there aren't any widgets. So here's our admin area. I'm going to go to Appearance, Widgets, and you can see our sidebar is completely empty. So I'll just grab a calendar and throw it in there. And then reload. And there we have a calendar. And it doesn't really look like a sidebar because there's nothing that actually makes it be in the side. So I'm going to open up our site again in Firebug. Close this up again so that we have masthead or site header class, site content class, and the site footer class. We'll make this just a little bit shorter. Now I'm also going to use a tool called the Web Developer Toolbar, which also has its own series on OS training. So if you'd like to see how to use all of that, you can watch that series. But I right-click, I go to Web Developer, then CSS, then Edit CSS. Now this bar allows us to edit any of the CSS being applied to the site. This is all inline CSS. Then there's dash icons, admin bar. There's some embedded stuff, but style.css is the file that we looked at before. And you can see there's the table of contents that we were accustomed to and all of this other stuff. Now, anything I do in this bar, you'll be able to see immediately, but it will not save. We're going to have to save it ourselves, and I can show you how to do that. But this is a really excellent tool for doing some on-the-fly build-out. Gonna make the bar a little bit narrower. And then I'm going to go right to the very bottom of this file. And right here, I'm going to put in some styles for class site, which is everything. So I'm going to put in .site. And then let's get some white space there. And then the curly brace. And now I'm going to say border 1px solid 000 is black. And there I have a border, except you can't really see it because it's right on the very edge. So now I say width 90%. And you can see that it brought it over here. That's too much. I don't like that. Let's say 98%. There, now there's just that little bit of white space over there. But I really want to center this. So I say margin, 0 for top and bottom, and auto for left, right. And you can see it centered it. So now there's a little white space there and a little white space there. You can't really see it. But there is a black line at the top. If you look very carefully, you could see it right here in the top left corner. And there's one at the bottom also, but that's hidden by Firebug down here. So now I want to do the same thing for site header. So I put in dot site dash header, and I want the same border. And now you can see that there's one all the way around. And now I want to do the same for site content. And there's that. And then site footer. There. Now it's easy to see, actually, that our content and the sidebar are both inside the site-content. So if we open that up here in Firebug, you can see we have primary and secondary. So then their classes are content area and widget area. So now, right here below site content, Let's say, content-area. Then I'm going to say width 70%. There, now you can see how it brought that right over. And then I'm going to say float left, which doesn't do anything yet because we also need to do the same thing to widget-area. So I'm just going to copy all of that because I'm going to use so much of it. We change it to widget-area. We make the width 30%. And just like that, because 30 and 70 make 100, they sit next to each other. Now I have more borders than I want. I actually don't want one around site content, so I'm going to take that right off. Now everything's pushed right up against its edges. I don't like that very much. So I'm going to throw in some padding. There, now in the header, there's a little bit of padding there. And that's nice. We'll do it on the content area. Pushes it off the edge there, that looks nice. We do it in the widget area. And we do it in the footer. And there we are. And now, if we want, we can start taking borders off. So let's take one off the entire site. You don't really notice because everything had one. But now let's also take one off of the content area and the widget area. So now we have a box around the header and the footer, and the content and the sidebar are just kind of floating there. And I like that, so I'm going to leave it the way it is. But as I mentioned, this doesn't automatically save. We need to do something to save this. So what I'm actually going to do is press Command A or Control A in Windows. Now everything's highlighted. And then I do Command C to copy. And now I'm editing style.css. Do Command A and delete, and it's all gone. Command V, and you can see now that I have all that stuff that I just built. And then Command S for save, or Control S. This editor I'm using is called the Sublime, and it's has a free demo, so you can try it out and see if you like it. And if you like it, I recommend you buy it. It's a good product. So now I close these, and you see it's gone. Now I'm going to reload, and there we are. Now things are a little wider because we did percentages. So our sidebar is still 30%, but it actually looks quite wide. But that's okay. What we really wanted was to be able to visually separate the header, the footer, the content, and the sidebar. And now we've done it. If we go to our blog post, you can see that it is similar throughout the whole site. We go to sample page, and there we are. So what we have here in the header is the title, the byline, and the primary nav. So in this series, we're going to take a look at adding some features to this theme. We're going to look at adding an additional widget area, or sidebar as it were, and some additional navigation, as well as a variety of other things. So I hope you'll join me, and we'll have a good time. In this video, we're going to start talking about menus. How to make them, how to place them, how to name them, and all that kind of thing. So first, let's take a look at what underscores has built in. You can see this sample page right here is a nav item. If we take a look at the header template near the bottom, you can see right here there's a block from line 41 to line 44 called nav. And in here is WP Nav Menu, which renders a navigation. Now, by default, it just shows all the pages, because we haven't made a custom menu yet. I also want to look with you at functions.php. And right down here on line 46, there's some code that does register nav menus. And this creates a menu location called primary menu. And I'm going to have to show you how it works because it's kind of hard to explain. So remember this primary menu. If we go to the admin area, under appearance, menus, there are no menus. So I'm going to make one up. I'll call it main menu. And I hit create. Now down at the bottom here, note theme locations, primary menu. So I'm going to add sample page. I'm going to add hello world. And I'm going to add Google. And I'm going to save menu. Now if we go look at our home page, you'll see that nothing happened, because we didn't say where this menu should go. We can choose primary menu and hit save menu. And now when we reload, it'll go right here. Sample page, hello world, Google. And the reason it goes there, we utilized the code that was in functions here for creating primary, and then in header, which says this theme location is primary. The menu ID is actually a CSS class that gets applied to the unordered list. Under functions, we created a menu location called primary and named it primary menu. And then under header, we said print a menu that's in the theme location primary and call it primary menu. And that's why this works. So I'm going to right-click on this and inspect element with Firebug. And right here, you can see, is the ID of primary menu. So this menu ID is a CSS ID, not a CSS class. So built right into underscores, we have some code that creates a location for a primary menu and some other code that prints whatever we put in that location. So what we want to do in our next video is create another location. And once we've done that, you'll see how easy it is to create as many locations as you wish. In this video, we're going to work at putting a nav menu into the footer. And several things need to happen. We need to create a location for it. We need to register it. Then we actually need to make a menu. So let's take a look at how that works. Because we're using underscores, we already have a block of code here called register nav menus with one in there, and we can simply add to it. But if you did not have this, if you were really starting from scratch, you would want to go to the WordPress codex and look up register nav menus. It's just a regular function. It takes an array as input, and this is an array. So ours has just one line, like theirs. Theirs has two lines. And this is very similar to what we want, so I'm actually going to copy and paste. Now let's take a look at the differences here. For one thing, for coding standards, we want these equals to line up. Now the underscores version has this escape underscore HTML double underscore in front of it. That does several important things. The escape HTML means that you can't accidentally put in some HTML in here that could break things. The double underscore means that this string should be translatable. So we need to take our translation identifier here and put it there also. There. Now, this string is safely and securely escaped and can be translated. Now, I don't want it to be footer menu, I just want footer. And I don't want my custom, so we'll just call it footer menu. There we are, which sounds inane, but WordPress coding standards say that in an array, the equals should line up. It helps keep things more organized. So now we have a primary and a footer. So let's come over here and we will create a new menu. We'll call it footer menu. And I'm just going to make up some custom stuff. Facebook.com, call it Facebook. Add to menu. And MySpace.com, because who doesn't love MySpace? Add to menu. Now let's save. And you'll note down here at the bottom we have primary, and now we have footer. And you can see that primary is currently set to main menu, which is another menu. So I'm going to choose footer menu and hit save. Now within this user interface, I want to show you one more thing. There's a manage locations up here. And here are all of our locations. And we could reset what we've already done. Or we could use a new menu. This is particularly useful if you have quite a few menus and you didn't already choose. You could just come through and say, this one is this one, and so on and so forth. But ours are already set. So now let's take a look at the front of our website. And we have no change. That's because we did not put in the code in our footer template to make that work. So let's go do that. First, I'm going to look at the header template. And here's this entire navigation block. I'm just going to grab the whole thing. And then we go to footer. And here's our footer. It starts on line 16 and ends on line 22. And I'm going to put it in front of site info. Now we want to change these CSS classes and whatnot because they're set up for the top. So we'll call this footer navigation. And we'll give it the class the same. And role navigation is fine. And here's a menu toggle, which we don't want at all because it relates specifically to the main menu. So here we have WP Nav menu, theme location. Footer was the one we made up. And the menu ID is the CSS ID of this thing. So we'll just call it footer menu. And that's it. So now I do Command S to save. And now when we reload, we have a navigation. Now it's not neatly CSS'd like the primary nav because underscores didn't know that I was going to make this. But you could use CSS to take the bullets off and float them left so they all made a nice horizontal line if you want. Or you could leave it in a block like this. It doesn't really matter. The point is that we were able to put a navigation into the footer. And now you could do multiple footer navigations. This one could be for your site. But you could make another one for the footer that is for social. In fact, let's go ahead and do that. I'm going to just copy this nav information here. And I'm going to put it below the site info. We're going to call it footer-social navigation for the ID, but the class will simply be social navigation so that we can apply CSS to all of the social navigations. And we'll call this one footer-social, and the ID will be footer-social-menu. But as you may recall, we also need to register this, so back to functions we go. And we're simply going to copy this line to this line. Call it footer-social. And we'll call it footer-social-menu. And then line up our equals again. Now, we should still get nothing when we reload. Ah, we did get something, because if we don't put something in the nav at all, it wants to go and get all the pages. So what we need to do is create a new menu, call it Footer Social, create, and it doesn't really matter what we throw in here. We'll throw in Hello World. And here you can see we have Footer Social menu. We check that and hit Save Menu. And now there's our Hello World. Now I sort of arbitrarily put these in the footer. You should put them where it makes sense for your theme. Maybe this one needs to be up here next to this one so you can float them left and right or something. It doesn't really matter. The point is that we used register nav menus to create the locations, and then we used WP nav menu to print those locations. And then in the UI, you can fill them up with all the content you want. Now, these menus can be used in more places than just these locations. They're regular menus, and you can use them anywhere. For example, if we go to Widgets, there's a custom menu. And you can choose whichever one you want. And there you can see that the primary menu is also being used in the sidebar. So the really significant parts of what we did today is register locations and then print things in those locations. The menus are sort of ancillary to the whole thing. You can use those menus anywhere you want. We just happen to want to use them in the locations that we made. In our next videos, we're going to take a look at doing something similar with widget areas, or sidebars as some people call them. In this video, we're going to talk about making new sidebars, and then in the video after that, we're going to talk about how to place them where we want. Right now, Underscores has one sidebar called Sidebar. And while this one is named appropriately because they put it in the side, sidebar is actually a misnomer. It's actually a widget area because you can put them anywhere you want. You can embed them in a post, you could put them in the header or the footer, or on your home page, in the center, or anywhere you wish. So from here on out, we're going to call them widget areas. So the first thing we're going to look at is making a new widget area. And the first step we're going to take is look at how Underscores made theirs. We're looking in functions.php. I'm just going to search for a widget real quick. And right here is a section called Register Widget Area. Now there are a couple of different things going on here. First of all, we're creating our own function called Motorcycle Widgets Init. And then we run that through add action, running it on the Widgets Init action hook. So basically, everything that happens inside our function will run on Widgets Init. And right now, only one thing is happening. They're running the function register sidebar, which takes an array of options. The first option is its name. It's called sidebar. And you may recall from another video how escape underscore HTML double underscore works. It sanitizes and validates this text so that no bad code could get through, as well as making it translatable so that someone who wants to translate your site into Spanish would be able to easily access that point. Then we create an ID, and this simply has to be unique on your site. Keep in mind that a plugin might come along and create a sidebar as well, and you would never know. So you need to have it be so unique that no one else would ever make it. Sidebar-1 isn't actually that safe. I probably would have named it something else. On the other hand, so would everyone else who is making a plugin that would create a sidebar, so it might be safe after all. Then we have description, which is blank. Let's just write something in there. And actually, because we're using plain text like this, we want to do the same thing they did up here. So I'm going to copy that and paste it there. Copy that and paste it there. And we'll be able to show you that in just a minute. And now we have before widget and after widget. And this is some HTML that gets wrapped around it. Now you'll see we have an ID here of %$1s and a class of %$2s. These are some placeholders that WordPress uses to fill in with some code. You don't really want to change that. If you added a third thingy over here, then you would want to use %$3s. But I can't think of what you would want to add that would need that. And then we have the closing aside. So basically, widgets are aside tags. Then we have before title and after title. And we're simply wrapping the titles in H2. And you could easily change that to anything you wanted. So I'm going to save this real quick. And remember, we made this description. There's no description here. We reload. And here you can see the description. So if we wanted to make more, I'm going to simply copy all of this, paste it here. And we'll call it header widget area. And we'll say appears in site header. We need to change the ID. So I'm going to prefix it. Our theme is called motorcycles, just because I had to make something up. So I'm going to prefix it. Motorcycles-header-widgets. There we are. Now I'm going to do Command S for save. And we will reload this page. And here we have a header widget area. And I'm just going to drag this one over there. And hit save. And now we have a widget in our header widget area. And we reload and nothing happens, because in our next video we're going to talk about how to make them render. We haven't done that yet. All we've done is create the areas. So I'm going to create one more. Note the order that they appear here is kind of the order they're going to appear on this page. It doesn't really matter, but I'm a nerd, so it matters. So we say footer widget area, motorcycles footer widgets, appears in the site footer. And that's it. I'm going to reload. And there's the footer widget area. And what will we add? We'll add the meta information. And again, this one should not appear because we haven't done anything to make it appear here. And that is the case. So what we've done is pretty simple. In our functions.php, we replicated the register sidebar that was there. Now, if you're working with a theme that doesn't have that at all, you can simply go to register sidebar on the codex. And it will tell you exactly everything you need to have in it. Now, our examples use an aside for before and after the widget. Their example uses a list item. The person who makes the HTML for your theme can use anything they want. It doesn't really matter. What matters is that it's styled properly and you know what it is. So to sum up, we have a function called motorcycles widgets init, which gets hooked into widgets init under this action hook. And in here, we just have three register sidebar functions. And that's it. In our next video, I will show you how to make these widget areas appear. In this video, we're going to take a look at how to position sidebars that we've already created. You can see here we have a header widget area, a footer widget area, and the sidebar. So first we're going to take the header widget area and put it in the header. So here's our header. The first thing we're going to do is take a look at how this one got here in the first place. We're going to look at index.php, which is the home page. If we go all the way to the bottom, you'll note there's a function right before the footer that says get sidebar. we're going to copy that. We'll go to our header. And between the top of the header and the nav, we're simply going to put this in. And I'll save and reload. And what we have is our regular sidebar. And it doesn't get printed a second time, which means it's just stuck up here instead of down here. And we don't want that. So here's the key. Here's how it works. We'll go back to functions. And we'll go down to where we registered those sidebars. And right here we have an ID. And that ID is very important. So I'm going to copy that. Now there's a file called sidebar.php. And that's what actually is getting rendered as the sidebar. So it checks to see if it's active. And if it's not, bails out. If it is active, widget area complementary. And we run dynamic sidebar with an ID, sidebar one. Except we need to keep this file exactly the way it is to render our regular sidebar. I'm going to do file save as. And now we have sidebar dash and then the ID of our sidebar, motorcycles header widgets dot php. And we hit save. And there, now you can see it right next to sidebar.php. So now we want to check to see if this one works. And if it does, run it. Except we want to change our ID from secondary because that's used by the regular main sidebar. So our ID will become also motorcycle header widgets, and we'll leave the class as widget area. And now we hit save. And we will reload, and you'll note that it's still not working. There's one more step. We're going to go back to the header, and we're going to find that get sidebar, and we're going to tell it which one to go get. Motorcycles header widgets. Now this get sidebar in the header knows to go looking for sidebar dash motorcycles dash header dash widgets. So it's going to go get this file, which goes to get the widgets in that sidebar. Now let's run it. And there we are. We have our sidebar back. And up here we have the one widget that is in our header widget area. Obviously, it's quite ugly. So we would want to use CSS and probably stick it up over here somewhere and maybe float the widgets side by side so that they didn't make the header super long. Or maybe you only ever want to have one widget in the header. But this allows you to easily put any widget in the header. So you could put a custom navigation in here, but it makes it very easy for your site maintainer to change which navigation that is, so they don't have to go edit your code. Or you could put a little weather map up there, or you could put any widget you want. The key is that it's very easy for the end user to change the content in that space because they're using widgets. Now we want to do the same thing for the footer because we made a footer widget. So let's go to functions, get our ID, then we pull up the header widgets file and we do file save as sidebar motorcycles footer widgets, and then we edit appropriately. And we save this. Then we go back to header and we grab the get sidebar. And then we open up footer and we simply need to put it someplace. I'm going to put it before the footer navigation, because then we can float it right and the navigation will come right up on the left side. And we change this to footer widgets and save. So what we did is create a footer widgets file, and then in the footer, call it properly. And so we can see that our footer widget area has meta in it. And when we reload, now we have meta. And of course, again, it is ugly. But with CSS, we could float this right and it would come way over here and our nav and stuff would stick back to the left and everything would be hunky-dory. So let's review a little bit. In our previous video, we edited functions.php and we registered some sidebar areas. And most notably, we gave them IDs. So then what we did is created files with the IDs in the file name. And we edited those files to call the IDs that we're working with using dynamic sidebar. Then on location, in header, we used get sidebar with the ID. And in footer, we used get sidebar with the ID. And that renders the widget areas. Now, the true beauty of widget areas is that it makes it super easy for a site maintainer to dramatically change the content in that area. Now, a designer may curse that idea because it allows the end user to change the way the site looks, and they could make it ugly, honestly. And some do. But for the most part, if you do it right, it doesn't have to be that way. You can change whatever's in your widget area. You could do a rotating staff member. You could do a rotating staff member. You could do a widget with a map and another one with a phone number and so on and so forth. Your options are really limitless. In this video, we're going to take a look at how to properly include JavaScript and CSS files. Let's take a look at the source of this one real quick. I'm going to do Command U. And here is the head of the file. And then down here we have some link tags. And then here are some more. And these are including style sheets. And then at the bottom of the page, we have some script tags, including JavaScript files. I'm going to show you how to put these in properly. Because if you don't do it properly, then there can be conflicts and clashes, and it can get pretty ugly. Now, the horrible bad way that you should never do is to simply open up header.php, find the header, and paste the link tag in there, or the script file. But this breaks the flow of WordPress. It makes it so that WordPress core does not know about your file. If you do it properly, then you can have things like dependencies. So if you write a script that requires jQuery, you can say that your script requires jQuery, and your blog will make sure that jQuery is loaded first. And you don't have to worry about that. If you're loading a CSS file that depends on another one, you can tell it about that dependency and it will make sure that the other one is loaded first, just like with a script file. So let's take a look at how to do that. Underscores does a little bit of it for us already. Let's open up functions.php, and then down near the bottom, we have a function here called motorcycles scripts. And everything in here gets run on the action hook called WP and Q scripts. So this is the place where we would want to do any of our additional CSS or JavaScript. The first thing they're doing here is WP and Q style. They're giving it a handle of motorcycle style, and then get style sheet URI, which gets styles.css for us. Now let's take a look at that in the codex real quick. WP and Q style wants a handle, which is a nickname you make up, a source, meaning where your file is, dependencies, a version number, and in the case of styles, media. Media being all or just screen or handheld or print or whatever. Now, most of these are optional. The handle is required, but that's it. Of course, if you don't give a source file, then you're not going to get anything either. Now, the other one they're using is WPNQScript, which is for JavaScript. And so they gave it a handle of motorcycles navigation, and they used get template directory URI, which gives us the path to our current theme folder, and then /js/navigation.js. So up here we can say there's JS and there's navigation.js. And they're also doing the skip link focus fix. And then they're optionally enqueuing some scripts for comment replies. And then they run all of these together at the same time on WP enqueue scripts, and WordPress sorts out what is supposed to be where. Now, I'd also like to look with you at the documentation for WP enqueue script, because while it's very similar, there are some differences. There's the handle, the source, dependencies, and version, but then you have the option for in footer. And you may recall from our source code that there were a number of scripts in the footer. So you can choose whether you want your script in the header or the footer. Now let's do a little example. I'm going to include a Google font. Here are Google fonts. I'm going to come down here and pick a cool looking one. I like PT Sans, so I'm going to click here for quick use. I'm going to scroll down here. And it says that this is the HTML that I should copy to my website. And if I were doing it the bad old way, I would just copy this link tag and stick it in header.php. But we're not going to do that. So I'm going to copy this. Single quotes, and that's it. So now we are enqueuing the style PT Sans from Google Fonts with this handle. So let's hit save and reload. And now we'll view source and search for PT Sans. And there it is, right there. So now that font is included. Now it doesn't magically use it because my CSS doesn't say to. So just for fun, let's go to Edit CSS. On the body tag, say, actually we can come over here and grab this code. There. So just for fun, I forced the entire body to use PT Sans. And you can see it switch like that. So that's how you properly include a Google font. Now, you'll note that with a script, they use get template directory URI and concatenated that with local JS file, which is why they were able to include their own JS right here. You could make a CSS file and include multiple CSS files if you wish. That's technically not very good for your download speed, but you certainly could. And it's an easy way for plugins to include CSS and JavaScript into your header without having to have access to your header.php file. Doing it this way properly makes it so that WordPress can manage all of these files and make sure that they're placed in the proper place at the proper time in the proper order and not break other people's themes and and not break other people's plugins and styles as they add them. So please make sure that you add them the proper way with the enqueue functions. In this video, we're going to talk about code standards. Writing your code in a standard way so that other people who come across it can immediately understand it and work with it in a comfortable manner. There are a variety of scenarios in which you might build a theme. One is for general release, and you might put it on .org and have thousands or millions of people use it. And some of those people are going to want to edit your theme and make changes. Another scenario is that you create it just for one site, and you deliver it as a product to a company and they put it up on their own site. Well, someday, either somebody inside the company or a follow-up developer is going to want to come in and make changes. And you want them to be comfortable as well. There are any number of scenarios in which somebody else is going to touch your code. If you follow WordPress coding standards, then it makes it much easier for someone else to be able to just walk into your code and begin working on it. Fortunately, WordPress has some very well-declared coding standards. This is the Codex, but the standards have all moved over to the Core Contributor Handbook. Fortunately, you can link to them from here. Let's look at the HTML coding standards first. All HTML pages should be verified against the W3C validator to ensure that the markup is well formed. That's very easy. You simply go to the validator and give it the URL that you want to look at, and it will tell you all the problems that you have. But there are some other things that the validator won't care about that are important. If we're using XHTML and we have self-closing elements, then we want to have a space before the self-closer. All tags and attributes must be written in lowercase. The description here is neither a tag nor an attribute. It's content, and so it doesn't matter. Using quotes. You can use double quotes or single quotes, but you should not use no quotes. Indentation. As with PHP, HTML indentation should always reflect logical structure. Use tabs and not spaces. And we can see that in index.html. We have our header and then we have our h1. And then if we go to template parts, content, there's some more HTML. You can see that they indent very nicely here. And then the credits show where we got a lot of these standards. But then let's also take a look at PHP coding standards, because as you can see, there's some PHP wrapped in here as well. You can use single or double quotes where appropriate. Note that we wrap our echo in single quotes because there are double throughout the link. But if we have singles in the link, then we want to wrap it in double. Now, ideally, we always wrap in single, because it takes less PHP parsing time. Indentation. You may recall from a video earlier in this series where I talked about lining up your equals. And here's an example. This is where they say it should be done. Brace styles. You should have spaces on the insides of your parentheses. You should have a space before your curly brace, and so on. The standards for PHP are a bit longer than the standards for HTML because there's more to it. But it's really not that complicated, and I strongly recommend you read through them all and follow them. There are also standards for CSS, mostly relating to structure. You can see they prefer to have them stacked vertically rather than horizontally. And then there's information about selectors and properties and property ordering, as well as vendor prefixes and values. And lastly, there are JavaScript coding standards. There's quite a bit in here about spacing, about objects, arrays, and function calls, and examples of good spacing. And semicolons? Use them. If you're going to be writing code for themes, follow the standards. They're there for a reason. You yourself will come back to this code someday and be grateful that you did, because it'll make a lot more sense. There's a saying, always write your code as if the next developer is going to be an axe-wielding psychopath who knows where you live. The easier you make it for the next person, the easier it will be for you when you are the next person. So please, read through the standards and follow them as you make your themes.